Shalom Aleichem, everybody. Ariel Bar Tzadok here from the Kosher Torah School, found online at www.koshertorah.com. Saludos y bendiciones desde Costa Rica. Blessings, greetings from here in Costa Rica. We are here in the Heredia province and enjoying a very lovely day as we explore this very interesting country, which has many, many different sides to it. But I'm not here so much to discuss Costa Rica with you, as much as to discuss something much more closer to my heart. And that is a very special book here called Sha’arei Kedusha. This is the Gates of Holiness, written ballpark about 500 years ago by Rabbi Hayim Vital, who was the famous redactor of the Torah of the Kabbalah of the Arizal. This is a very interesting book, which I have already taught the real deep parts of. The book is divided into four sections, and parts 3 and 4 deal with the introduction to and then the practices of the prophetic Kabbalistic meditation system. So those courses are already available on our Kosher Torah School website, www.koshertorah.com. Go to our page, which has our courses, and you'll see the full syllabus outline of each and every lesson. Over a dozen lessons between the two of them, maybe 2-3 dozen. But the first sections of the book, I never really covered. I've translated sections from time to time, but I've never really covered them before. And as we say, et lasot l'shem, the time has come. So this is what we're going to do. Now, a point that I want to make is, why did Rabbi Chaim actually write this book? And what the heck does any of that from 500 years ago have to do with us today? And the answer is actually rather profound, because Rabbi Chaim opens up his book and he makes a statement, which is actually a quote from earlier literature, which says, I've gazed and looked around for what we call the Bnei Aliyah, and they are mu'atim, very, very few in number. These Bnei Aliyah are those who are actually able to make We call this Ruach HaKodesh in Hebrew, but it actually means actual, realistic, psychic contact with the higher domains. This was a practice widespread in ancient Israel through temple times, through the times of our sages, the Tanaim and the Amoraim of the Gemara, and even after that. In biblical times, we saw the examples of this with the famous visions of course, Ezekiel and Daniel and the like. Well, a point that's made very clearly by Maimonides in, again, Mora Nebuchim, his Guide to the Perplexed, which some consider a book of philosophy, but many are becoming aware that underlying his philosophy are many of the identical concepts that are discussed in what is called mysticism. So the rationalist mind of a Maimonides and the mystical mind of the Kabbalah, well, on the surface, they are completely opposed to one another. But when you really get down to the brass tacks, as we say, they're really not so different at all. Maimonides makes it very clear in the Mora Nebuchim that which we call Ruach HaKodesh, divine inspiration, psychic, intuitive development and advancement of consciousness, it's not a gift. It's not a prize. It's not for the select few. It's the natural evolutionary destiny of every human soul who thus chooses to embrace it. And even, it doesn't actually quote it there in the Mora, the best of my knowledge. If I'm not mistaken, it's a Helik Bet, Perek Lamed Bet. But the point is, this is an older teaching that we have brought down to us from a Midrash, which is actually in the name of none less than Eliyahu HaNavi, Elijah the Prophet, Eliyahu Rabbah, Perek, Tet. Men, women, Jewish, non-Jewish, free or slave, and especially in today's political times, those terms might be coming back into great relevancy. Well, everybody can receive Ruach HaKodesh, receive. Yeah, that's that word Kabbalah, based upon one's actions. In other words, what one does. So if you want to make aliyot, you want to really have psychic access to the higher dimensional planes to kind of gain a glimpse of what the heck is going on in our strange world, you can do it. All you have to do is take the proper steps. Think of it like this. If you want to build a strong, muscular body, what do? You follow an appropriate plan of diet and exercise, which will include bodybuilding and the like. And with the amount of effort you put in, you will gain results. I mean, that's just the way things are. Well, it's the same thing with psychic development. We have an ability to grow, but to quote the wise words of a fictional character, but like Rabbi Huda says in the Mishnah, is Yehu Hacham, who is wise, Alomed Mekol Adam, one who learns from every man. Well, I hope that he will allow me to extend that to include fictional characters. Remember little Master Yoda from Star Wars? One of the first things he said in teaching the character of Luke Skywalker was, you must unlearn what you have learned. Now, in our day and age, where what we call fake news is pretty much the norm, and no one knows what to believe anymore, one of the great fake news or fake beliefs that people have is the limitations that the world places on the advancement and the development and the evolution of human consciousness. You see, I'm involved with the television program Ancient Aliens, and while I certainly love the people at Prometheus Productions who make the show, don't think that as an Orthodox rabbi, I can agree with all the other opinions that are expressed by the other guests on the show. I most certainly do not. Well, I know Giorgio and, of course, Eric von Daniken, and many things we agree full well. But other things we don't, and that's just the way it is. But needless to say, it's their television program, not mine. So they don't always give me my say. That's why I wrote my book, Aliens, Angels, and Demons, which is available both first and second edition on Amazon.com. I don't sell them directly. You've got to go through Amazon. But my point again is, take a look at, like, Daniel. Daniel is interacting with all of these angels, and there was a real political intrigue with it. Do you remember the story in the book of Daniel, which is discussed in my book, Visions of the End of Days, available on Amazon, in which Daniel sends a prayer to God. Hey, God, give me an answer. And he prays and prays. It takes over a month for his prayer to be answered. And in a dream or a vision, the angel Gabriel comes to Daniel. And Daniel said, hey, I've been praying for a month. Where the heck have you been? Would you like miss the boat? And he goes, I had a hard time coming into Persia where you live because the angel of Persia held me back. What the? The angel holds you back? Yeah, he says, I had to go and get Michael and we got into a big fight, blah, blah, blah. And you sit and you read that story and you go, what the heck is that all about? Well, this is something that's actually elaborated by our sages. We know that there is, remember those watchers from the books of Enoch, the fallen angels from Genesis 6? Well, their punishment, not so much as recorded in Enoch, but their punishment was to stick around here and to get the job done. So they became known what we call a heavenly Sanhedrin, or a group of angels. And they are guardians, if you will, the watchers, book of Daniel. They're not always nice guys, you should know. Like Rabbi Abraham Azulai makes clear in his Hesed LaAbraham, these guys will fight like bucking rams. And when they do, the nations that are under their influences are psychically influenced by them to fight as well. So if you look at our crazy world today and you ask what on earth is really going on, you have to recognize that there is, let's be honest, an angelic influence. And don't think angels as good guys. Now, a good point that I like about our Ancient Aliens program is that it gives me the opportunity to make a very clear Torah-based point, which is that when we talk about angels and demons or extraterrestrials, we're really talking about the same thing. No, angels. Angels and demons aren't flying around in little metallic spacecraft shooting ray guns. No, we have to expand our definitions and understanding of what these entities are. They're not so much extraterrestrial from another planet, even though some are. They are more interdimensional. Well, that brings us right into spiritual concepts and understandings of the levels and grades of heaven. If you remember in the Gemara, it speaks of the levels of heaven. So we know all about these things, but to know about them from a book is one thing. To be able to gaze upon them with your own eyes and to experience them, that's something else. And that is why Rabbi Chaim wrote the Sha’arei Kedusha, because like me, 500 years ago, he recognized, my gosh, we live in crazy times. And the only real salvation in crazy times is going to be to get people reconnected back to the source. This was actually echoed in a vision dream of none less than Rabbi Yisrael ben Eliezer, the famous Baal Shem Tov, the founder of Hasidut. He had a dream vision on one Rosh Hashanah, where he did the Aliyot exercises that we practice here from the Sha’arei Kedusha. And he had a vision where he saw Mashiach. And he goes, yo, we've been waiting a long time for you. What's going on? And Mashiach says to the Baal Shem Tov, when you got to understand, when your teachings spread around the world and people are able to make Aliyot, just like you're doing now, that is what we need to make the era of dawn of Mashiach to come. Well, as the old saying is, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Well, we're in tough times now, so it's time for the tough to get going. We really need to focus on real Aliyot exercises. No, they're not dangerous. Don't listen to those naysayers who are, let me be blunt, and I'm sorry if I'm offensive, they don't know what they're talking about. They have no experience with these things. All they could do is quote to you what a book says. This book says this and that book says this. Well, let me tell you something. I know what the books say. I know what we're doing. And we're not doing what others think is being done. We're connecting with God, which is actually a fulfillment of a biblical commandment of Devikut, like it says in, you know, the Parsha, Atem HaDavakim Bashem Chaim Kulchem Hayom. Those who you are bonded to God are alive to this day. So bonding, Devikut, is a Torah obligation. That's something that's written in all the codes. We begin, of course, by visualizing God's name. The only name God himself ever revealed himself as, which is Yud, Ke, Vav, Ke. That's, you know, the famous tetragrammaton that we find in the Torah. That is a form of the revelation of the divine in our world and consciousness. So we take that from the Torah. We use the Hebrew letters and we visualize it wherever we are, whatever we're doing. And we thus fulfill literally the words of Psalm 16, verse 8, Shiviti Hashem lenegdi tamid. I place God before me always. Now, recently on a Facebook post, I made a comment and I said, before you think God. Before you feel God. Before you speak God. I ran out of space, so I couldn't conclude. Before you act with God. There's nothing else you need to know. Put God before you in everything, and you'll see how everything works out okay. This is what we do. So how do you do it? You can't just say a prayer, Lord, okay, I'm doing this. No, you visualize the name Yud Kevav Ke. You follow the techniques and the tools that we teach, and we allow that imagined image of God's name in your mind's eye to actually take form through your imaginative faculty. Sounds like Rambam. But it's all the prophecy secrets. Rambam knew what he was talking about. And you allow your imaginative mind, which in Kabbalah speak we call the Sefirat Chochmah, wisdom, to influence and penetrate your intellectual mind, Sefirat Bina. And between the two, you find that through your imaginative, which brings you into a psychic and an intuitive awareness, which then becomes, if you will, digested by the intellectual mind, to emerge some semblance of awareness, which we call in Hebrew, dot. Now, this process I'm actually writing about in a series of essays right now. I'm posting them, of course, through our Kosher Torah School website, and you'll find them on our Patreon page. I even post them from, in serial form on both Facebook and YouTube, and the material is out there. But it's not enough that you just read it. You have to use it. So, on that note, God be willing, I'm going to start a bunch of series of these little classes based on what Rabbi Chaim here teaches in the first sections of the Sha’arei Kedusha, which I have not yet put publicly out there as I have the last two. Check out those last two. You're going to find them of great value. Again, Kosher Torah School, no, actually, just koshertorah.com. Go to our page of courses. You'll see all the way down the meditation, Kabbalah section, the Sha’arei Kedusha parts 3 and 4. Take those courses. You'll find just how valuable they are for you. And then stay tuned here. Stay tuned to our Kosher Torah School. See what I have to offer. And again, it's not about me. It's about the learning. It's about you. It's about your experiencing the greater, higher values of what's going on around us for yourself. Because that's really the only ticket out of all the craziness that's going on here. So, with God's grace, God be willing, I'll see you all in classes to come. Barachot tovot, blessings. All right, I really got to practice my Spanish. You know, I speak it brokenly. But I feel like, you know, the old Midrash says about Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, that he was aral sefatayim, that he really couldn't get the words out. That's how I feel sometimes trying to speak Spanish. But okay, gracias a Dios, God's grace, God be willing, thank you to God, we'll get it out. So again, saludos, bendicios, bendiciones, desde Costa Rica, me aquí en Heredia. So blessings to you all, and God be willing, we'll talk soon. Shalom.